Hello students, let us continue with chapter 1 in snapshot, The Summer of the Beautiful White Horse by William Saroyan. So before moving ahead, let me summarize what I have explained in my last video. Okay, so let me give you a short summary of what I have explained in my last video. And I hope you must have watched my last video. So in this beautiful story, which is about Armenian tribe, one day 9-year-old Aram was asleep and was in a world of extremely beautiful imagination. His life was pleasant and kind of. In a mysterious dream, his cousin Murad showed up on the window of his room at 4 in the morning, at early in the morning. He called Aram. He jumped out of his bed and still couldn't believe what he saw out of the window. It was dawn and there was light enough outside. It was the time of early morning, but it was light enough outside to make him see outside what made him believe he was not dreaming. Murad was sitting on a white horse. Aram rubbed his eyes and stuck out his head out of the window. Murad assured him it was not a dream. He asked him if he wanted to ride. He must make it quick. Murad was the type of person who enjoyed being alive, but he couldn't believe that he was seeing a horse in front of him. Aram's earliest memory was of horses, and he always wanted to ride one. This was the wonderful part, that he was actually going to ride on a horse in real. Aram's family was poor and had no money, so it was difficult for him to believe in what he saw outside the house. He belonged to the Garuglenian family that was strictly and funnily in poverty. So they were very poor. They were poverty stricken. They didn't even know how they managed to get food for themselves every day. Although his tribe was poor, they were known for their honesty for 11 centuries. They were honest, proud, and always believed in right and wrong. No one from their family would ever steal anything or would take advantage of anyone in the world. Aram was so excited that he was seeing a horse that was so pleasant and beautiful. He could smell it and hear it breathing and still couldn't believe that Murad or anyone in the family could afford a horse. He was thinking if Murad had stolen the horse, but he didn't believe it, as he thought no one in his family could be a thief. He started at his cousin and then at the horse. He started staring at his cousin and then at a horse in shocking, as he could not believe that Murad was sitting on a horse. There was religious, motionless and wittiness in both Murad and the horse, as one charmed him and the other scared him. He asked Murad. If he had stolen the horse, Murad replied, if he wants to ride, he must jump out of the window. Okay, so it's all about yesterday's video. So let's begin. The remaining part of the story. So today I'm going to start explanation from here. Well, okay. In last class, in my last video, I explained till I chose. So now I'm going to explain from well. Well, it seemed to me stealing a horse for a ride was not the same thing as stealing something else such as money. So here, because Aram, the narrator, was also loving the dog very much, also wanted to take a ride of a horse. So that's why he said, stealing a dog for ride, not such as stealing money. So it seemed to me stealing a horse for a ride was not the same thing as stealing money. Yes, stealing a yell such as money. So he said, stealing the horse is not like stealing money. They are not same, they are different. Further, he gives the reason, and by giving reason, he said, for all I knew, maybe it wasn't stealing at all. So I'm sure that it was not stealing. If you were crazy about horses, the way my cousin Murad and I were, it wasn't stealing. If you are crazy about anything, if you are, you know, longing, loving the thing too much, if anyhow you want that thing, then it is not a stealing, according to Aram, according to the narrator. So narrator said, if you were crazy about horses, the way my cousin and Murad and I were, it was not stealing. So if you are crazy about horses, if you have a craze about horses like me and my cousin Murad, so it was not a stealing. So stealing a horse was not like a stealing money. It wouldn't become stealing until we offered to sell the horse, which of course I knew we would never do. So it wouldn't become stealing. It cannot be considered as stealing until we offered to sell the horse. Until we sell the horse. If we are not going to sell the horse, then it is not stealing, because we are not selling the horse for money. Okay, so which of course I knew we would never do. So narrator was sure that they would never sell the dog. If they would sell the dog, then it will be called stealing, as it is not their intention to sell the dog. So it is not stealing. It cannot be considered as stealing. Yes, let us continue. It wouldn't become stealing until we offered to sell the horse, which of course I knew I would never do. Let me put on some clothes, I said. So further, Aram, the narrator, said, let me put on some clothes. He said, let me put on some clothes. All right, he said, but hurry. Then Murad replied, all right, but hurry up. I leaped into my clothes. So hurriedly, the narrator, Aram, put on his clothes. I jumped down to the yard from the window and leaned up onto the horse behind my cousin Murad. So he jumped down to the yard from the window. So the narrator also wanted to ride the horse. He was also in a hurry. So he jumped down to the yard from the window and leaped up and jumped up onto the horse behind my cousin Murad. So his cousin Murad was already on the horse. So Aram also jumped and he also sat behind Murad. That year we lived at the edge of town. So that year they were living at the edge of the town on Walnut Avenue. The name of the place was Walnut Avenue. Behind the house was the country. So behind our house was the country, and behind their house there was a city. Country means village here. There was a village, vineyards, orchard, irrigation ditches, and country roads. So behind their house there was vineyards, a plantation of grapevine used in winemaking. Okay, orchard, it was vineyards, garden, and irrigation ditches, and country roads. So it was behind their house. In less than 3 minutes we were on Olive Avenue, and then the horse began to trot. So in less than three minutes they reached on Olive Avenue, on another place, and then the horse began to trot. Then the horse proceeded for running faster, proceeded on with them. The air was new and lovely to breathe. So the air was new, they were enjoying the air. So you know, now it is the time of morning, and they were riding on horse, and a horse, now they were moved ahead from the populated area. It was an open area, so that's why he says that the air was new and lovely to breathe. The feel of the horse running was wonderful. So the feel of the horse running was wonderful, as he also wanted to ride a horse. It was first time when he sat on the horse. So all these things both of them were enjoying. My cousin Murad, who was considered one of the craziest members of our family, began to sing. So here the narrator says that his cousin Murad, who was considered one of the craziest members of their family, he started singing loudly, that is roaring. Every family has a crazy streak in it somewhere. So every family has, you know, a crazy race somewhere. Such type of person present in every family. Okay, and my cousin Murad was considered the natural descendant of the crazy streak in our tribe. And my cousin Murad, he was considered a natural descendant. You know, descendant means a system that develops from an earlier simple version. So descendant, the next generation. So Murad was the natural next generation of the crazy race in their tribe, according to the narrator. Before him was our uncle Khusro. So before Murad, there was another crazy person in their family whose name was Khusro. And Khusro was uncle of Aram, an enormous man with a powerful head of black hair and the largest mustache in San Joaquin Valley. Okay, so here the narrator describes the personality of his uncle Khushro. He says that Khushro, his uncle Khushro, was an enormous man, a heavy man with a powerful head of black hair. So he had a powerful head and black hair and the largest mustache in the San Joaquin Valley, one of the long interior valley of California. So in that, in whole San Joaquin Valley, so he was having the largest mustache. Okay, a man of furious in temper, so a man who gets angry very, very soon, you know, frequently. A man so furious in temper, so irritable, so impatient. So the narrator Aram has used many adjectives for his uncle. So he was so furious in temper, so irritable, so impatient, and that is stopped anyone from taking by roaring. So he says that he gives a description of his uncle and he says that he was so furious in temper, so irritable, so impatient that he was able to stop anyone by roaring. So he had a quality of roaring, talking loudly. Okay, and he used to say, "It's no harm, pay no attention to it." So it was his patent line. He always used this line, used to say this line. So what may come, he used this line: "It is no harm, pay no attention to it, whatever the matter." He always used this line, so it was his patent line. That was all. No matter what anybody happened to be talking about, so it doesn't matter what matter anyone was discussing to him. It doesn't matter whatever a man talk about to him. He used to say only this line: "It is no harm, pay no attention to it." So that was all. No matter what anybody happened to be talking about. So it doesn't matter what anyone talking about, asking to him, whatever the matter. So without knowing the matter, he promptly used to say only, "It is no harm, pay no attention to him." So he always used to say, "No harm, pay no attention to him." Okay. So once it was his own son Arak running 8 blocks to the barber shop where his father was having a mustache trimmed to tell him their house was on fire. So once what happened, once when he was getting his mustache trimmed in a barber shop, in a saloon, then his son Arak, he went running there and informed Aram's uncle Khushro that his house was on fire. So this man Khushro sat up in the chair and roared, "It's no harm, pay no attention to it." So as it was his patent line, so that's why he kept on sitting in the chair. He did not stand up. He kept on sitting there and there was no worry on his face. Okay, so simply he said, "It's no harm, pay no attention to it." So even if his house was on fire, his son went to him and informed him, but it made no difference. So simply he replied, "It is no harm, pay no attention to it." The barber said, But the boy says, your house is on fire. The Baba also, you know, replied the same that in order to remind him, the Baba said, but the boy says, your house is on fire. So Khushro roared, enough. It's no harm, I say. So again, Khushro roared in a loud voice. He said, it's no harm, I say. So he always, whatever the matter, doesn't matter, whatever anyone, what matter was discussing with him, so it did not make any difference. He always used to say, it is no harm, pay no attention to it. Even if when his house was on fire, his son came to inform him at Baba's shop when he was getting his mustache trimmed. He said, it is no harm, pay no attention to it. So here the narrator Aram compares Murad, crazy Murad, with his uncle Khushro. And he tells us that there is one crazy person in each family. Okay. My cousin Murad was considered the natural descendant of this man. So further he said that his cousin Murad was considered the natural descendant of this man. This man means Uncle Khushro. So Murad was considered the natural descendant of Uncle Khushro. Although Murad's father was Zorab, who was practical and nothing else. He was not like Khushro. Even though Murad was crazy like his uncle Khushro. That's how it was in our tribe. So he said, that's how the people of my tribe behave. So it is all about the people of his tribe. A man could be the father of his son's flesh, but that did not mean that he was also the father of his spirit. Yes, the very important line here, the narrator says that a man could be the father of his son's flesh, a man could be the father of his son's body, but that did not mean that he was also the father of his spirit. So it does not mean that the man is also the father of his spirit. A man cannot be the father of his son's spirit. He is only the father of his son's flesh, his son's body. The distribution of the various kinds of spirit of our tribe had been from the beginning capricious. So here the narrator says that distribution of the various kinds of spirits. So there were various kinds of people in narrator's tribe. They were taking birth from beginning, okay, in consistent change of mood and vagrant. So such people, vagrant means a person who is homeless. So such homeless people and such people of inconsistent change of mood, having such qualities, having such traits, so people took birth in his family before also. It was not the first time. So such distribution of various kinds of spirits, various kinds of people in his tribe. So here he gives a small introduction about his tribes by saying that, so as in each family there is a crazy man. Earlier Khushro, my uncle, was a crazy man. Now Murad. So it's an distribution of generation to generation in his tribe. We rode and my cousin Murad sang. So they were riding on horse while his cousin Murad was singing. For all anybody knew, we were sitting still in the old country where, at least according to some of our neighbors, we belonged. Okay. For all anybody knew, we were still in the old country where, at least according to the some our neighbors, we belonged. So for all anybody knew we, so those who knew their tribes still in old country, they were still in their old country, at least according to the some our neighbors, according to the some neighbors, some of some people of their tribe, they were living still in their old country, you know, their native country. Still some of the people from their tribe, they live in their native country where they belonged. We let the horse run as long as it felt like running. So they let the horse run as long as the horse ran. Okay. At last my cousin Murad said, "Get down, I want to ride alone." So at last his cousin, Aram's cousin, the narrator's cousin Murad said, "Get down, now you get down, I want to ride alone." "So will you let me ride alone?" I asked. So narrator also wanted to ride alone, so that's why, so he before getting down he asked, "So will you?" If he would also let him ride alone. So Aram asked him if Murad would allow him to ride alone. "That is up to the horse," my cousin said. So his cousin Murad replied that it depends on the horse. "Get down." So once again he said, "Get down." "The horse will let me ride," I said. So Murad said, "Okay, the horse has no objection. He will let me ride. We shall see." So further he said, "Okay, if the horse will allow you to ride, then we will see. We shall see. Don't forget that I have a way with the horse. So don't forget that I have a way with the horse." "Well," I said, "anyway you have with a horse, I have also." So he said, "Don't forget that." So I took this horse, okay, and I am with him, and I rode the horse. So he said, the narrator Aram said, "Well, I am also rode the horse with you. It is not only you who rode the horse." So for the sake of your safety, he said, "Let us hope so." So he said, "For sake of your safety," as he was of 9 only. So here, for the sake of his safety, he said, "Okay, let us hope so. If the horse will allow you to ride, so it will also allow me to ride." So that's why he said, "Okay, let's see what happened. But now get down." So he was emphasizing Aram. He was emphasizing the word "get down" again and again, because he wanted to ride alone. He wanted Aram to get down. "All right," I said, "but remember, you have got to let me try to ride alone. So, but remember, you don't forget to give me the horse to ride again, to let me try to ride again. I also want to ride alone. So let me try to ride alone on the horse." I got down and my cousin Murad kicked his heels into the horse and shouted, "Wazire, run!" So the narrator Aram got down and his cousin Murad kicked his heels into the horse and shouted, "Wazire, run!" So the way one operates a horse and make a horse run, so Murad did the same. The horse stood on his hind legs. So the horse now stood on its hind legs. It means now the horse in a position of running very fast, snorted and burst into a flurry of speed that was the loveliest thing I had ever seen. So now here it was a surprising speed for the narrator, and narrator had never seen such a speed at which the horse was running. My cousin Murad raced the horse across the field of dry grass and an irrigation ditch, crossed the ditch on the horse, and 5 minutes later returned dripping wet. So his cousin, the narrator's cousin Murad, raced the horse, he ran the horse across the field of dry grass and to an irrigation ditch, crossed the ditch on the horse, and after 5 minutes he came back and he was dripping wet. So he got wet fully due to sweat. Okay, so it's all about today's video. In my next video I will explain the rest part of the chapter. Thank you for watching the video.